we have discussed the provisions relating to the residential status, and now we will be discussing the scope of total income, because the tax incidence, it depends upon what the residential status. So we have seen an individual and HUF have three status: either they can be resident, they can be not ordinarily resident, or they can be non-resident. And the other persons, whether it is a company, whether it is a firm, AOP, BOI, local authority, artificial juridical person, they have two status: either they can be resident or they can be what? Non-resident. So why we are making a distinction that a person is a resident or not ordinarily resident or a non-resident, the same depends upon the residence, that is the scope of incidence basically depends upon what? The residential status. Whether the global income will be taxable or only the Indian income will be taxable. So that is depending upon the residential status. Now that has been provided in section 5. Section 5, it deals with the scope of total income. Section 5, it is dealing with what? The scope of total income, that is the tax incidence, depends upon the residential status. Now say, in case the income is received in India, income is received in India, whether the income accrues in India or outside India. So in case the income is received in India, if the income is received in India, then it will be taxable whether the person is a resident, whether a person is a not ordinarily resident, whether a person is a non-resident. So whether he is a resident, whether he is a NOR, whether he is a NR, the same will be taxable. Income which is received in India. Then the second one is, in case the income is deemed to be received in India. In case the income is deemed to be received in India, whether it accrues in India or outside India, if it is received in India or it is deemed to be received in India, in both the cases, it will be taxable in all the three cases, whether the resident it is there, or say NOR is there, or say NR is there. The income deemed to be received in India, buyer on his behalf, it will be taxable whether he is a resident, whether he is a NOR, or whether he is what? NNR. Then income which accrues or arises in India. Income which accrue or arises in India, whether received in India or say outside India. Income which accrue or arises in India, it may be received in India or it may be received outside India. It will be taxable whether the person is a resident, whether the person is a not ordinarily resident, or whether a person is a non-resident. Similarly, if the income is deemed to accrue or arise in India, the income is deemed to accrue or arise in India, the same will be taxable whether he's a resident, not ordinarily resident, or non-resident. So here, in these four cases, whether income is received or deemed to be received in India, income accrue or arise in India, or deemed to accrue or arise in India, the same is taxable in all the three cases. But say, if the income which accrues and arises outside India, income which accrues and arises outside India, as well as it is received outside India, and it is by deeming fiction, it is not deemed to accrue or arise in India or deemed to be received in India, then it will be taxable in case of a resident. It won't be taxable in case of a NOR, and it won't be taxable in case of NR. But in case of NOR, in case of NOR, income which accrues outside India and is received outside India will be taxable. Income which accrues outside India and is received outside India, the same will be taxable if it is from business controlled from India or profession set up in India, or say profession set up in India. Now here This is the exception basically. In case of NOR, the income will be taxable if it is received and accrued outside India. But the same is from business control in India or profession that is what set up in India. This is basically the scope of total income. Why we have made a distinction? Because the tax incidence depends upon the residential status. Now we'll be discussing what do we mean by income which is received in India, income deemed to be received in India, income accrue in India, income deemed to accrue or rise in India. So first of all, we have to make a distinction between what receipt and remittance. Receipt and remittance. Why we have to make a distinction between receipt and remittance? Basically, receipt refers to the first occasion. Receipt refers to the first occasion when the recipient gets money under his control. Receipt is what? Receipt, it refers to the first occasion when the recipient gets the money under his control. Subsequently, it is said to be remittance. Subsequently, it is said to be what? Remittance. Now here, receipt in India is taxable. Receipt in India is taxable and not the remittance. Now, look, from whose point of view this is important? This is important from non-resident point of view. Whether the income is received in India or say it is received outside India. Because in case of non-resident, we have to see. We have to see the same in case of what? The non-resident. Say here, if Mr. X is non-resident, Mr. X is non-resident. Now he has what? A house property, say in UK. He has a house property in UK. He has given this house property on rent to Mr. Y. Now Mr. Y deposits the rent, say, in two different cases. One is in Mr. X account in India, and say in Mr. X account outside India. If the same has been deposited in, say, bank account outside India, and subsequently Mr. X remits the money in India, it will be what? Received outside India and then remittance. In that case, it won't be taxable. If the same has been directly deposited in Mr. X account in India, in that particular circumstance, it will be regarded as kya? Received in India. It will be regarded as what? Received in India. So here what we have to see is, there's a distinction between what? Receipt and remittance. Basically, we have to make a distinction between, say, receipt and remittance. And Here, what is the distinction? Receipt refers to the first occasion when the recipient gets the money under his control. Subsequent transmission of the income to another place, it is known as what? Remittance. Now, receipt of income is taxable. Remittance of income is not chargeable to tax. Basically, if the person who is bringing the money is acting as the agent of the payer, then the income is said to be received in India. So, if the person who is bringing the money from outside India is acting as the agent of the payer, if he is acting as an agent of the payer, then the income is said to be received in India. In case the person who is bringing the money is acting as the agent of the payee, in that particular circumstance, the income is said to be received outside India because the payee has received the same outside India and subsequently it is what? Remitted to India. What we have to see? We have to make a distinction between receipt and remittance. Besides this, what they are saying is, in case if any foreign income is accruing and arising outside India and it is not it shall not be deemed to be received in India, foreign income which is accruing or arising outside India, the same shall not be deemed to be received in India merely because of the reason that it is included in the balance sheet which is prepared in India. Merely because of the reason that it is what? Included in the balance sheet which is prepared in India. So fundamentally, foreign income which is accruing or arising outside India shall not be deemed to be received in India merely because of the reason that is included in the balance sheet which is prepared in India. Then, in case if any income is taxable, it is taxed basically on accrual basis. It is accrued to us, it has been made taxable. Then it is subsequently received in the second year. So it won't be taxable again when it is, say, received. So income once taxed on in the previous year on accrual basis shall not be again taxable on, say, receipt basis. So income once taxed in the previous year on accrual basis shall not be again chargeable to tax on what? The receipt basis. Then receipt of income is important. Only that income will be taxed in India which is received in India and not remitted to India. Only that income will be taxed in India which is basically received in India, not remittance. It is not, as we have already told you, remittance is not taxable. What is taxable is receipt. And basically income should specifically relate to a previous year, and according to section 6(5), if a person is resident in respect of one source of income, then he'll be regarded as a resident in respect of what? All other sources of income. If he's a resident in respect of one source of income, then he'll be regarded as a resident in respect of all other sources of income. Now, section 7 is dealing with what? Income deemed to be received. The following incomes will be what? Deemed to be received. That is section 7, income deemed to be received. So here, number one is, whatever contribution is made by the employer in recognized provident fund, if it is in excess of 12% of salary, then it will be what? Deemed to be received in excess of 12% of salary. And interest which is credited to the recognized provident fund in excess of 9.5% per annum, the same will be deemed to be what? Received. So first one is, the employer's contribution to recognized provident fund in excess of 12% of salary, that is employer's contribution to the recognized provident fund in excess of 12% of salary, and interest credited to PF in excess of 9.5% per annum, the same will be taxable. So whatever contribution is there, here in recognized provident fund we'll be discussing the concept in salary. Employer contributes and employee also makes a contribution. and that contribution, whatever amount is contributed, that is invested in the government securities, and interest is earned. So if your employer's contribution is in excess of 12% of salary, though you will be receiving the PF amount afterwards when you leave the organization or when you retire from the organization or your superannuation, but that will be deemed to be received. The income is deemed to be received in that previous year itself when the there is an excess contribution in excess of, say, 12% salary and interest in excess of, say, 9.5% per annum. So that is the annual accretion to the credit to the recognized provident fund. Then one is what? The transferred balance. It is transferred balance, say, from unrecognized provident fund to recognized provident fund. In case there is a transferred balance from the unrecognized provident fund to the recognized provident fund, had the fund been given recognition from the very inception, had the fund been given recognition from the inception when the fund was set up, whatever is the employer's contribution and interest thereon, that would have been taxable on year-to-year basis, will be taxed in the year in which the fund is given the recognition. So that is what? Deemed receipt. That will be regarded as what? Deemed receipt. So whatever amount is transferred from the unrecognized provident fund to the recognized provident fund, that will be taxable. Besides this, whatever contribution is made by central government or any other employer in the previous year, contribution which has been made by central government or any other employer in the previous year under pension scheme, which has been referred under Section 80 CCD, that is a new pension system trust is there. And the employer also contributes here in the NPS account of the employee. So when the employer is contributing in NPS account of the employee, it will be regarded as what? Deemed receipt. So as per Section 7, these are the what? The deemed receipts. These are regarded as what? The deemed receipt. One is what? The employer's contribution to the recognized provident fund and interest which has been credited to the recognized provident fund in excess of what? 9.5%. And employer contribution excess of 12%. Other one is transferred balance from the unrecognized provident fund toward the recognized provident fund. And then the contribution made by the central government or, say, any other employer in the pension, new pension system trust account of the employee. Besides this, there are further certain deemed receipts, say, cash credits, unexplained investments, unexplained money, unexplained expenditure, these are all deemed receipts in the year in which the same is found. Whatever cash credits are there, whatever unexplained investments are there, unexplained money is there, investments which are not fully disclosed, amount borrowed or repaid on hundis and unexplained expenditures. Then next is what? Tax reduction at source in the hands of the payee. Tax reduction at source in the hands of the payee and deemed profits which are taxable under Section 41. Deemed profits which are taxable under Section 41. So these are basically deemed receipts, and they will be income, the same side will be the income which is what deemed to be what received in India. So Section 7, it is dealing with income deemed to be received, and the same will be chargeable to tax whether the person is a resident, whether he is a not ordinarily resident, or whether he is, say, a non-resident. Now, next was income which accrue or arise in India. Income which accrue or arise in India. Income which accrue or arise in India, same is taxable. Now, basically what accrual of income is? accrual of income is what? Accrual is right to receive. Basically, accrual is right to receive. That is, an unconditional liability is created on the payer to pay the requisite amount to the payee. Accrual is that unconditional liability is created on the payer to pay requisite amount to the payee. So here, accrual basically refers to right to receive, and when the income is due, when the assessee gets right to enforce the payment of the same. Say for example, if Mr. X gives interest, gives money on say loan, and say the interest, it becomes due on say half yearly basis. The due date is half yearly here. So here, the income, interest income, though accrues on daily basis, but will become due on half yearly basis. He won't have a right to enforce the payment of the same before say it becomes say due. So here, fundamentally, say we have made a FDR, quarterly interest is due, then on quarterly basis we can enforce the right of payment of the interest. Though interest accrues on daily basis, but here it will be due when the assessee gets a right to enforce the payment. Salary for work done in December will accrue throughout the month, day to day, but the same will become due either on 31st December or 1st January. So income is taxed on accrual basis, the same will not be taxed again on what? The receipt basis. Now here, this is basically accrual of income. Then section 9, it deals with what? Income which is deemed to accrue or rise in India. Section 9 is very, very important. Section 9, it deals with what? Income deemed to accrue or rise in India. That is section 9. Section 9 is dealing with what? Income deemed to accrue or arise in India. This is section 9. It is very important section which provides that in the following cases, the income will be deemed to accrue or rise in India. And when the income is accrue or rise in India, it will be taxable. So income which is deemed to say accrue or arise in India it will be taxable in all the three cases whether the person is a resident, whether he is a not ordinarily resident, or whether he is a non-resident. Now here, in which case the income will be taxable? Say, first of all, which are the incomes which are deemed to accrue or rise in India? We have 911, likewise, subsection 1, clause 1, subsection 1, clause 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, likewise we have what? These clauses. So first one says that income which accrues or arises directly or indirectly, that accrues or arises directly or indirectly, which accrues or arises directly or indirectly through or from, which accrues or arises directly or indirectly through or from, say, any business connection in India. Any business connection in India, through or from any business connection in India, say asset in India, source of income in India, property in India, or say transfer of capital asset situated in India. So income which basically accrues or arises directly or indirectly through or from any business connection in India, asset in India, source of income in India, property in India, or say transfer of a capital asset which is situated in India, that income will be regarded as deemed to accrue or arise in India. That first one is income accruing or arising directly or indirectly through or from any business connection in India, property in India, asset in India, source of income in India, or transfer of capital asset which has been situated in India. That is 911. We'll be discussing this section 911 in detail because it's a very, very important section. And it's important from the non-resident point of view. In case he's a non-resident and he is having, say, any business connection in India, or say property in India, source of income in India, or he's transferring any capital asset which is situated in India, then in that case, though he's a non-resident, income is deemed to accrue or rise in India. And when the income is deemed to accrue or rise in India, the same will be what? Chargeable to tax in India. Besides this, 912 is what? Salary earned for services rendered in India. 913 is Indian citizen, government employee, services rendered outside India. Income will be deemed to accrue or rise in India. And 914 is dividend paid by an Indian company outside India. So they are dealing with the provisions relating to what? The taxation. Then 915 is there, 916 is there, and 917 is there. 915 is dealing with interest. Interest which is payable by, say, if it is payable by government, if interest is payable by government, the same will be deemed to accrue or rise in India in hands of the recipient. If it is payable by a resident, then it will be taxable. It will be payable by a resident. It will be taxable in case, except in the following cases. If the money is borrowed, say it is payable by a resident, right? The interest is payable by a resident, it will be deemed to accrue or rise in hands of recipient. Except when the money is borrowed or debt is incurred in case of for business or profession which is carried on by such person outside India. If the money is borrowed or say debt is incurred for the purpose of business or profession outside India, or for the purpose of making or earning any source of income, say, outside India. And in case, if it is a non-resident, he has borrowed the money has been utilized for the purpose of business or profession carried on by him in India. So if a non-resident has borrowed a money and is paying interest, then if the money is utilized for the purpose of business or profession carried on by him in India, then in hands of the recipient, the interest income will be regarded as deemed to accrue or rise in India. Don't worry about the same. We'll be discussing. Similarly is the royalty, and similar is the fees for technical services. Royalty and FTS, if it is payable by the government, then in that particular circumstance, income will be regarded as what? Deemed to accrue or rise in India in hands of the recipient. Similarly, royalty and fees for technical services, the same is payable by a person who is resident in India, then the royalty or say fees for technical services will be deemed to accrue or rise in India, except what? When the same is utilized for this royalty is paid for what? rights, information, etc., which has been used, or say services which have been utilized for the purpose of business or profession, which has been carried on by such person outside India, or earning any source of income outside India. Except that in all other cases, that royalty in the hands of a recipient will be regarded as accrue or arise in India. Then in that last case, in case a non-resident has, say, used those rights, property or information, if the non-resident has used those rights, property or information, in that particular circumstance, that, you know, that will be utilized, that has been used for the purpose of business or profession carried on by him in India or earning any source of income in India, then in hands of the recipient, that royalty and fees for technical services will be what deemed to accrue or arise in India. So that is, we will be discussing this in depth now. So first of all, 911 is saying what? What section 9 is? 9 is income which is deemed to accrue or arise in India. So all incomes which are accruing or arising, whether directly or indirectly, through or from, say, any business connection in India, property in India, asset in India, source of income in India, or through transfer of capital asset which is situated in India. So here, say, Mr. X is a non-resident. He is having, he has a branch office, non-resident, he is in UK, HO is in UK, and branch office is in India, and the income attributable to Indian branch is 5 lakh rupees. Since Mr. X is having a business connection in India, so the attributable income will be what? Accrue or arise in India. Say Mr. X is having a house property in India, which has been given by him on rent, which has been given by him on rent of, say, 50,000. 50,000 is the rent which he is earning. In this particular circumstance, whatever the rental income is received, the same will be deemed to accrue or arise in India. Similarly, if he is having any asset or source of income in India, he will be, that income will be regarded as deemed to accrue or arise in India. Even if Mr. X is a non-resident, it will be what? Chargeable to tax in India. Now, what basically business connection is? In case if you say appoint any agent in India, you have any branch office, you have any subsidiary company in India, by virtue of them, you will be regarded as having, say, business connection in India. So a business connection involves a relation between a business which is carried on by a non-resident. Here it involves a relation between was business which is carried on by a non-resident, which yields profits or gains and some activity in India, and the same contributes directly or indirectly to the earning of those profits and gains. Normally, business connection involves element of continuity, and business connection involves element of continuity. And isolated transactions are not normally regarded as business connection. The isolated transactions are, they are not normally regarded as what? A business connection. And business collection basically also includes professional connection also. Professional connection is also covered in the ambit of business connection. Now, what basically business connection is, the same has been provided in Explanation 2 and Explanation 2A. We will be first of all discussing the Explanation 1. Of section 911, which provides that here, in case of a business of which all the operations are not carried out in India, then the income which is attributable to the operations carried out in India will be regarded as what? Deemed to accrue or arise in India. So only income which is attributable to the operations which are carried out in India. So say global profits are say 2,50,000. Global sales is 25 lakhs, and sales in India is 10 lakhs. So income which is attributable to the operations carried out in India is what? 1 lakh rupees. So this 1 lakh rupees will only be what? Taxable in India, that has been provided. So that is what, in case of business, other than a business having business connection in India on account of significant economic presence. In case of a business, other than a business having business connection in India on account of significant economic presence. So this has been amended by the Finance Act 2020, of which all the operations are what? Not carried out in India. Of which what? All the operations are not carried out in India. The income which is deemed to accrue or rise in India shall be only such part of income. The income which is deemed to accrue or rise in India, the same will be only such part of income which is attributable to what? The operations carried out in India. That has been the first part. If all the operations are not carried out in India, then the income which is attributable to the operations which are carried out in India, that will be regarded as what? Deemed to accrue or rise in India. Then the second one is, say, if a non-resident, exception it is, if a non-resident purchase goods in India, if a non-resident purchase goods in India for the purpose of export out of India, if the non-resident purchase goods in India, why is purchasing goods in India? For the purpose of export out of India, then no income shall be deemed to accrue or arise in India. No income shall be deemed to accrue or arise in India. So here, in case income is earned by a non-resident engaged for purchase of goods in India for the purpose of export out of India, then it won't be regarded as what? Deemed to accrue or arise in India. So if a non-resident purchase goods in India, for what purpose? For purpose of export out of India, income won't be regarded as what? Deemed to accrue or arise in India. Besides this, in case it is a non-resident, he is engaged in the business of running a news agency or say publishing newspapers, magazines or journals. Non-resident is engaged in the business of running a news agency or say publishing newspapers, magazines or journals. So no income will be regarded as accrue or rise in India from the activities which are confined to collection of news and views in India for transmission out of India. No income will be regarded as accrue or rise in India from kya? Collection of news and views in India for the purpose of transmission out of India. No income will be regarded as accrue or rise in India collecting news and views for the purpose of transmission out of India. Then say, if a non-resident is engaged in shooting any cinematograph film in India, if a non-resident is engaged in shooting any cinematograph film in India, then income won't be deemed to accrue or rise in India. In case he is an individual, he must not be citizen of India. In case it is a non-resident firm, then no partner must be citizen or resident in India. And in case of a non-resident company, then no shareholder must be citizen or resident in India. In such case, income won't be regarded as what? Deemed to accrue or rise in India. So in case of income which is earned from operations of shooting any cinematograph film in India by a non-resident, being an individual who is not a citizen of India, a non-resident firm which do not have any partner who is citizen or resident in India, or a non-resident company which does not have any shareholder who is either citizen of India or resident in India. In that particular circumstance, income will not be regarded as what? Deemed to accrue or rise in India. Similarly, in case of a foreign company, it is what? There is display of uncut or unassorted diamonds. In exhibitions, in special notified zones. So no income will be regarded as accrue or rise in India. So here, income earned by a foreign company engaged in the business of mining of diamonds through or from activities which are confined to display of uncut and unassorted diamonds in special notified zones by central government in official gadget. So here, no income will be regarded as accrue or rise in India to a foreign company which is engaged in the business of mining of diamonds through or from activities which are confined to display. They are displaying the uncut or unassorted diamonds in the exhibitions which are taking place in the special notified zones. In that regard, that income will not be accrue or rise in India in that case. So these are basically the exceptions, though they are having certain sort of a business connection in India, but income is not accruing or arising in India. Now that has been provided in explanation 1, and rule 10 provides that you will be apportioning the profits either on the basis of the turnover or on the basis of receipts or on the basis of such other manner as may be considered suitable by the assessing officer. Now, explanation 2 to section 911 provides for the concept of business connection. It is providing the concept of, say, business connection. Now, what basically business connection here is? So, if they are non-resident, is carrying out any activity, they have appointed agents in India, then by virtue of these agents, the non-resident will be regarded as having, say, business connection in India. So what type of agents have been appointed? Say he has appointed a concluding agent. He has appointed a concluding agent. That is what? That agent has been given an authority to conclude contract on behalf of non-resident. Or say he plays a principal role leading to what? Conclusion of contract. And contract is concluded by the non-resident. Then in that particular circumstance, that non-resident will be regarded as having a business connection in India by virtue of any agent. So here, the business connection, it will include any business activity carried out through a concluding agent. That he is what he has and habitually what exercises in India an authority to conclude contract on behalf of the non-resident, or habitually concludes contract, or habitually plays a principal role leading to conclusion of contract by that non-resident, and the contracts are in the name of the non-resident, or for transfer of the ownership or granting of rights to use property owned by that non-resident, or that non-resident has a right to use, or for, say, provision of services by the non-resident. So fundamentally, he is playing a principal role either in concluding the contract, that agent, or he is concluding the contracts in that particular circumstance, that by virtue of that concluding agent, the non-resident will be having regarded as a business connection in India. Say Mr. John is a non-resident. He has appointed Mr. Ram concluding agent. Either Ram concludes the contract on behalf of the non-resident or Ram plays a principal role in concluding the contract. Ram is entering contract on behalf of Mr. John. So by virtue of Mr. Ram, Mr. John will be having regarded as having business connection in India in that case. And contract, they are in the name of the non-resident, or they are for the transfer of ownership or granting of rights to use property owned by that non-resident, yeah, that non-resident has a right to use, or for provision of services by the non-resident. Besides this, if say a NR appoint stocking agents in India, if the NR appoints stocking agent in India, in that particular circumstance, he will be regarded as having, say, business connection in India. So he has basically no authority, but maintains in India a stock of goods or merchandise. Maintains in India a stock of goods or merchandise from which he regularly delivers goods or merchandise on behalf of the non-resident. So by virtue of that stocking agent, that non-resident will be having, say, a business connection in India, or is an indenting agent or procurement agent. That is, a non-resident is securing orders in India mainly or wholly for the non-resident, and that non-resident and other non-residents who are working under the common control. So basically, by virtue of the concluding agents or stocking agents or the indenting agents, that non-resident has been is regarded as having, say, business connection in India. Now here, exceptions have been provided that in case the broker, or say is a general broker, or is a general commission agent, or is having agent having an independent status, by virtue of him, that non-resident will not be regarded as having business connection in India. The business activity which is carried out through a broker or a general commission agent or any other agent who is having, say, independent status, acting in ordinary course of business, is not regarded as having, say, business connection. Besides this, exemption 3 provides that by virtue of this agents, only that much of the income which is attributable to the operations carried out in India, the same will be regarded as deemed to accrue rights in India. So as per exemption 3, where business is carried on in India through a person specified in A, B and C above, only so much of the income, these agents, only so much of the income as is attributable to the operations which are carried out in India, the same will be deemed to accrue rights in India. Then an exemption 3A, the same has been inserted, and this has been inserted by the Finance Act 2020 with effect from assessment year 21-22. It has been introduced with effect from assessment year 21-22. So they are extension, this is basically the extension of the source rule, that is the income attributable to the operations which are carried out in India, as has been referred in expression 1, shall include what? Income from such advertisements which targets a customer who resides in India or a customer who accesses the advertisement through IP address located in India. So here the advertisement, though the advertisement is done out of India, but that is targeting a customer who is residing in India, or the advertisement is accessed by a customer whose IP address is located where? In India. Then income which is attributable to such advertisement will be deemed to accrue or rise in India. Income attributable to operations which are carried out in India will include these incomes. Sale of data. If there is a sale of data collected from a person who resides in India, there is a sale of data collected from a person who resides in India or from a person who uses IP address located in India. Sale of a data is from a cursed person, which is collected from a person who resides in India, is collected from a person who uses the IP address located in India, or say sale of goods or services. Sale of goods or services using data collected from a person who resides in India or from a person who uses the IP address located in India or from a person who uses the IP address, which is what? Located in India. And say explanation 4, we have seen that if there is a transfer of a capital asset situated in India, then if any income arises through transfer of a capital asset situated in India, then in that particular circumstance, income is deemed to accrue or rise in India. So here the expression through has been defined to include the expressions by means of, that is by means of the transfer, if the income arises, that will be regarded as deemed to accrue rise in India, or in consequence of the transfer or by reason of the transfer, the income accrues or arises, it will be regarded as deemed to accrue rise in India. Then explanation 5 is there. What explanation 5 provides is, an asset or a capital asset, an asset or a capital asset, say is a share or interest in a company or entity which is incorporated outside India. The same will be deemed to be situated in India if the share or that interest derive its value substantially from the assets which are located in India. So if we have Mr. X is owning say shares of XYZ Inc. And this XYZ Inc. has made investments in India. So here this share of XYZ Inc. is deriving its value substantially from say assets located in India. XYZ Inc. is deriving its value from the deriving its value substantially from the assets located in India. In this particular circumstance, here the share of XYZ Inc. it will be deemed to be situated in India. And in case of any capital gains, if any capital gains arises from transfer of shares of XYZ Inc. If capital gains arises from transfer of shares of XYZ Inc., then it will be what? Taxable in India. Taxable in India. So that has been provided. However, these indirect transfer provisions, the same will not be applicable to foreign portfolio investors if they are category 1 foreign portfolio investors. So fundamentally, what we have seen under 911 is, what we have seen under 911 is that the income which accrues or arises in India, that is from say if you are having say any business connection in India, or if you are having any property in India, or if you are having any asset or source of income in India, or if it is through transfer of a capital asset which is situated in India, in these cases the income will be regarded as deemed to accrue or rise in India. And when the income is regarded as deemed to accrue or rise in India, then the same will be what? Taxable in India. 912 will be discussing in our next lecture, 912, 913 onwards.